Hey everyone, Nick here, continuing with our week-long Christmas gift to our Green Rush listeners. Today, it's my turn as the Green Rush team is republishing and highlighting some of our favorite episodes of the season. One of the coolest parts of my job is getting to be part of this podcast, and that means that every once in a while, I get called on to pinch hit for Ann or Lewis if they're away. So, naturally, when it came down to wanting to choose our favorite episodes, I wanted to pick one that featured me. So, for my episode, I'm calling back to when Ann and I got to interview Grammy Award winner and a member of one of the most legendary families in music history, Ziggy Marley. The Marley name is practically synonymous with cannabis culture, so being able to bring him on to chat about his music, his dad, and his own involvement in the cannabis industry was a real treat and one of the highlights of the year for me. Ziggy was incredibly generous with his time for this interview, and I think this conversation is one that all of our listeners will enjoy all over again. So relax and enjoy our conversation with Ziggy Marley.
The Green Rush is real. From lawmakers and investment bankers to CEOs and investors, we'll look at how people are transforming cannabis from the shadows of the black market into a cash crop that draws in cannapreneurs from Hollywood to Wall Street. Here to help you navigate the business of cannabis, please welcome Lewis Goldberg and Ann Donahoe, brought to you by KCSA Strategic Communications.
Welcome to another episode of The Green Rush. I'm Ann Donahoe, and today my co-pilot is our assistant producer, Nick Opich. Lewis Goldberg, my usual partner in crime, is actually out in LA at the Cowen second annual Cannabis Summit. So we'll have a full recap of that conference in one of our future episodes. Today, we are speaking with music and cannabis royalty, Ziggy Marley. Very few families embody what the Marley family does in terms of its impact on the world of music, but also on the world of the and culture of cannabis. We usually speak with entrepreneurs and people in the business of cannabis, but we are truly in rare air today as we chat with the 8-time Grammy Award winner, humanitarian, philanthropist, singer, songwriter, producer, entrepreneur, and the list goes on. Ziggy has a new album coming out called Rebellion Rising. It comes out May 8th, but you can pre-order it now. I highly encourage you to check out the title track that's out now. I can say it's most definitely on repeat on my playlist. He's also embarking on a North American tour this summer and will be touring Europe later this summer. We'll have all of those details in our show notes. And now, without further ado, here is our conversation with the one, the only, Ziggy Marley.
So, Ziggy, first question. Thanks again for coming on here. So growing up, I'm a little bit younger. Your dad was on t-shirts all over my high school, and you, your father, your family, you guys are all really commonly associated with cannabis culture in the U.S. How does that feel to have your whole family so publicly associated with the cannabis cultural movement?
I mean, we feel good because I think for so long, the plant has been demonized and criminalized, and we stand up for the truth, you know, so that's a part of the truth is the truth about this plant and the benefits of it and what it can do for society, both from a medicinal or recreational point of view, but also from the hemp side of things, the industrial side of things, you know. So we're happy with that.
So can you talk a little bit about the Marley Natural brand and your involvement in that? This really appeared to be the first time that the Marley family was actively putting its name behind a cannabis product. And, you know, are there any other plans to get further involved in the cannabis industry or, you know, opening your own dispensary or, you know, is your family thinking about different strains? You know, I guess what can we expect from the Marley Brothers venture in the future?
We're taking it slowly. We're taking it easy. You know, we're not rushing it. We're just trying to navigate the space as things will become more clear, because as we know, state-wise things change, but federally things aren't changing in the United States yet. So we're being very cautious and being very slow in what we're doing. I think the idea is to just try to give people a good perception of what this plant is, and a good a more natural way of using the plant, I guess, you know, in different ways. So,
right.
Yeah.
I mean, like that, you know. And I know that, and you know that, you know, brand really matters. And when it comes to consumer products, your brand is so closely enshrined in the culture of cannabis. How do you and your family maintain the Marley brand authenticity? because you do come off as so authentic and you don't, you know, back products that, that you're not using. And, you know, it's just, that's a feeling that comes across. And I'm just wondering how you guys accomplish that.
Well, I mean, sometimes it's difficult because it's a few of us have to make decisions, and, you know, people, each one of us might have a different thought about things. So it's a real, it's a real diplomatic way of trying to maintain one identity with multiple people's personality involved in trying to maintain just one identity when everyone is not thinking the same way, you know. So diplomacy and understanding.
I can only imagine how hard that is with as many siblings as you have. So kudos.
Yeah, and understanding, also understanding the people that you're talking to, because the people that you're talking to know the Marley. Some of them know the Marley brand more than we know the Marley brand, or have a higher standard than we would even have. So we have to be respectful of the people that we are speaking to when we're using our brand as a way of reaching out to them, and be respectful of how they see my father's legacy and how they see us and who we are. So, you know, it's a two-way street, because if we go the wrong way, people will know it's not authentic, you know. Mm-hmm. So we use the people as a guide for us as well, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, absolutely. So, Ziggy, I kind of want to, like, shift gears a little bit here. So we have you on our cannabis podcast, and I think it's essential that we talk about your comic book, Marijuana Man. The superhero got his powers from marijuana, but he didn't get them from smoking cannabis. I got a couple of questions on this. So first, what made you want to write about a cannabis-themed superhero, and why did you not want him to be smoking in the book?
Well, so I've been a comic book fan from I was a little boy. My imagination, you know, I have a big imagination. And I always love comic. I always used to doodle around in classrooms and, you know, draw Batman and draw planes and stuff. So I love comics. And I always wanted, I always have some crazy ideas, like writing down some ideas that I have. So Marijuana Man was one of the ideas that I came up with. And this actually, it's been years in the making in terms of my knowledge of the plant. Because I think when I was a teenager, I got this book called The Emperor Wear No Clothes. I think, I forget. Have you heard of that book?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Like a famous fairy tale, yeah.
No, not the fairy tale. It's about cannabis.
Oh, I don't know it.
Oh, I don't know that
you
one.
Guys, yeah. So that's the first time I was exposed to the different uses of the plant. And how Jack, is Jack Herer? You know Jack?
Yeah.
You know that name?
Yeah. Yeah.
I think he wrote that book.
Okay.
But it documents the plant and its thousands of uses. And so I was like, wow, this is important. And so with that knowledge and with what I was seeing in society of how the plant was being, like, disrespected and, like, people calling it drugs and, you know, it's right up there with heroin and crack and all of this shit. I was like, that's not right. That's not true. And so I wanted to create a representative of the plant in that would be a hero instead of a villain, which was how the plant has been portrayed for, you know, many, many years. So we came up with Marijuana Man, but the issue with it was not, it's not about smoking the plant. Smoking is one way of accessing the benefits of the plant, but there are other ways of accessing the benefit of the plant. And I didn't want it to be a stereotypical marijuana idea. Oh, this guy smokes, and you know, that's stereotypical to me. So I didn't want the guy to smoke. I want him to absorb it in a fantasy way or whatever way, you know, absorbs the energy from the plant, just like how Superman gets his energy from the sun.
So So is there going to be a future additions to this? Are we going to see it as part of maybe the Marvel Universe? See a movie theater?
No. Just one.
One and done. So, Ziggy, you have a new album coming out called Rebellion Rises, and you're kicking off a world tour this summer. And you will have a link to all of Ziggy's tour dates and a link to pre-order the album. But the new single, it's the title single that's out, is actually really infectious, but also a rallying cry to stand up. Can you talk a little bit about what inspired you to write that song, and who exactly are you standing up to?
Well, the song writes as a representation of not any particular subject or not any particular movement, but all of humanity. I see. It's a protest song that all of humanity can be a part of, regardless of if you're in the Me Too or the Black Lives Matter or the guns thing or whatever. We need something that all of humanity can be a part of, and what that is, we understand it as the rebellion against the negativity, the rebellion against the idea of the divisiveness that we see in the world today. The rebellion against that is for regular, normal human beings who are not in political powers or religious power to come together and love each other. That is the rebellion. That is the biggest rebellion. And so we speak for all of humanity, not for any specific group or any specific subject, because we still, even though each individual social cause is important, the cause that we all must be a part of is the cause of more loving of one another on earth, because that will help to solve many of the problems that we face. So there still needs to be a voice and a movement that represents all of humanity, not just one social cause or that social cause, but the cause of all humanity. And that is what Rebellion Rises is. This is what the album is about. It's about the cause of all humanity.
I love it, and I think it should be piped through the entire city of Washington, D.C. Let's take a quick break. We'll be right back with Ziggy Marley. And we're back with the one and the only Ziggy Marley. Another thing that you're, I guess, almost equally as well known for is your commitment to your family and to your kids. And you've written a family cookbook and children's books and albums and videos. You've been on Sesame Street, like the holy grail of everything kids. And you're a philanthropist and you work with various children's charities. So, and on the cover of your new album, is that one of your kids?
Yeah, two of them. You can't see that. There's another guy there too, but yeah.
Oh, is there? Okay. I was only able to see the one. It's the cutest little tushy ever.
Of course.
So, as a dad, how do you talk to your kids about the plant? And what advice do you have for other parents about, you know, in the U.S. as, you know, it's 29 states. So, you know, parents are starting to have, you know, this discussion. So,
good question.
How do you do it?
Yeah, first thing, my actions speak. So I don't use marijuana around my kids. It's not appropriate for them to be around it. So I suggest don't use marijuana around kids. If you're gonna smoke it, especially don't let kids shouldn't be around that. But I do speak to them truthfully about the plant. I tell them it's nature, and as my culture dictates, nature is a part of my medicine cabinet. Mm-hmm. Nature is a part of how we keep ourselves healthy. I also explain to them the plant has many uses and many ways of using it. Some people smoking, but I do make a point of saying that smoking is not good. If you put the smoke in your lungs in general, that's not such a good idea. So smoking is not good. But the people use it for, you know, if they're sick. Some people use it just to relax. Some people, like for me, I don't drink alcohol. And so I explained to them that some people use alcohol as a way of, like, after a hard day at work, some people might drink a beer or something. And some people don't use alcohol at all. They use marijuana as the equivalent of, wow, it was a hard day at work, let me relax a little bit. And so I tell them the truth. I don't hide it from them. I don't hide the truth from them about what the plant is and what the purpose of the plant is and what the uses of the plant can be. So I give it to them straight. I just don't expose them to the effects of marijuana. You know what I mean?
Right.
Their
kids,
makes sense.
Teen, whatever. They shouldn't never, ever have that around the kids where they could be affected by it at all.
Do you, as you see it...
Except for medicine, you know, epilepsy,
right,
or whatever, the ointments and stuff, yeah.
So
how do you...
Oh, go ahead, Nick.
Just to speak real quick on the medicine part, how do you separate the two, like the cannabis for medicinal when you're talking to them about it, and the cannabis for more recreation and relaxation?
Well, as I said before, like I would say, you know, some people who have cancer, AIDS, or sometimes you know it helps them, their appetites, let them handle the chemotherapy. And the recreation, like I said before, sometimes people come home from a hard day of work. Life is hard, man. People struggling, people working hard to make a bill pay, and sometimes them just want a break from the stresses, and sometimes marijuana can give a break from the stresses. Instead, they take, like, some kind of pill or some kind of, you know, synthetic drug. You use nature. That is what nature is for. Nature has given us everything that we actually need. And if we can find a way to use nature and live in harmony with nature, there will be less sickness, less stress. So that marijuana is just, marijuana is one plant in nature, which is how I kind of portray it, as it's just a part of nature. It's one plant, just like mint, just like, you know, any other tree that we use for medicines, turmeric, whatever the plant is. It's just a part of nature.
So we do a segment every podcast called Puff Puff Pass, and we ask our guests to tell us two things they love about the cannabis industry and one thing that drives them nuts. And it's kind of a rapid fire first thing that comes to your mind. So two things you love, one thing you hate.
Well, I love the freedom of the people getting from what's happening in the cannabis industry. I think that's the one thing I love. I don't know if there's two things I love, because I'm not an industry type person. I'd rather people grow their own, you know, marijuana, grow their own tomatoes as much as we can. It's beneficial for us to grow our own. Stuff I don't like, though, that might I might have a few more of that.
You so can I'm do worried as about many pesticides. Passes as you want, Ziggy.
I'm worried about pesticides. I'm worried about not knowing, especially now, as I said, it's getting commercialized. It's getting to the point of industrialized, where it's a, you know, it's a massive for-profit industry. And as we've seen in the past, when things become for-profit, sometimes how it affects the consumer isn't considered as much as how it affects your pocket. Mm-hmm. So, you know, the guy that's doing the industry, he wants to make money. So I'm worried about pesticides. I'm worried about the over manipulation of the plant away from its natural way of being. So I'm not into, like, people trying to make it stronger than it should be, you know, trying to, like, do some crazy stuff. So I'm not into that. I don't like that. I'm nature. I like nature. I like things. I like the ocean how the ocean should be. I don't want somebody messing with the ocean to make it a better ocean. You know what I mean? I like the tomato where the tomato is. You know, that's how nature meant. I like the herb the way the herb's supposed to be, the way nature intended to be, with as minimum of human manipulation as possible. You know, we still need to take care of it and do some things, but minimally. So I'm worried about those things. And I'm worried about the industry becoming just another industry, just another for-profit industry, losing the magic that this plant has had for centuries. If it becomes just like another product out there that is being sold to people, you know, it loses. To me, that is not the essence of the plant. You know what I mean? The essence of this plant is of harmony and love and unity and humanitarianism and togetherness, you know. So we have to be careful, because we can do more harm than good if we're not careful how we go forward in this industry. We could just become another product that, at the end of the day, you know, we don't like the way they do it, because, again, for profit, it's, you know, what do I need to make more money? Oh, right, the plants, I need to be able to put this thing on the plant that I put there to make the plant. But, you know, it's too much. Just give me nature, please. Just give me nature.
Make
this plant. Don't turn this plant into just another for-profit product that, you know, we're going to just, let's keep it grassroots, you know.
I like it. Yeah, keep the herb the way the herb is.
Yeah, man. That's the best way, that, man. Otherwise, yeah. At least that's for me. That's how I am, you know.
Do you grow?
Yeah, man. What do you mean? What do you mean? We have to grow some myself. I grow everything, though. Not just herb. We have to grow my food. You know, I grow my aloe vera. I grow things. It's not just about herb. This philosophy is not just about marijuana. It's about a lifestyle in general that goes beyond marijuana. It goes about the whole thing, our whole existence, and how we should be in communication with nature and grow your own stuff, man. Grow a little bit of your own stuff, whether it be food you eat or the herb you use, you know, grow some of your own. That's the most important thing.
I love that. Well, thank you so much, Ziggy. We want to be respectful of your time. It was such a thrill and an honor to speak to you. And we're good luck with the album. We're excited to hear the rest of it. I've pre-ordered it.
Thank you. Yeah, man. Thank you.
Yeah, good luck with everything and take care.
All right.
Thanks, Ziggy.
Bye-bye. Okay.
Now on to an update from Lewis, who was at the Cowan Cannabis Summit earlier this month.
I was at the Cowan Conference earlier this month in Los Angeles. Cowan, if you're not familiar with them, is one of the premier investment banks in the United States, and they are one of the few that will actually do cannabis deals. And we had Vivian Azer on about 6 months or so ago. Vivian is the only significant stock analyst who covers the cannabis space. And this was their big investing conference where there were a couple of hundred either super high net worth individuals or institutional investors, people who ran family offices, to hear about 30 or so different companies talk about the major trends that they're seeing in cannabis, the difference between Canada and the United States, the difference between packaging companies and companies that touch the plant. I mean, it was really fascinating.
Did you go to the conference last year?
I did. Last year, the conference was in New York City, and it was much smaller, both in attendees and length. I mean, this was a full day, and I think they could have probably done 2 full days of these types of panels, but I think Vivian would have died because she did the whole thing herself. But it's the quality of the investor in the room. I mean, there were, people from bulge bracket banks and well-known family offices who were listening so that they could decide where to invest. What's going
the
on?
Bulge this, brackets this, for where yeah. they can invest?
I think there is an assumption that sometime in the next 2 to 5 years that it's going to go completely legal and that at a minimum it will be descheduled. And if not outright, like the repeal of prohibition, at least to the point where if they deschedule it, the stock markets, both the New York Stock Exchange and the NASDAQ, will allow for the listing of public companies. That changes the whole tune for these investment houses because today they can't put institutional money to work and they're putting, their own resources. Not that far away they will, and they're preparing and they're really trying to learn. And some of these companies are going to be Amazon and Apple and, huge companies. And some of them are going to be pets.com. But the only way that you can know is if you start to really pay attention.
Who was your
favorite? I don't know, your friend.
Yeah. I guess who surprised you the most? What panelists surprised you the most? Anything jump out at you?
Yes. So there was a panel with Kevin Murphy, CEO of Acreage Holdings, who is our client, Ben Kovler, the CEO of Green Thumb or GTI, who we interviewed, and then Adam Bierman, the CEO of MedMen. And, these are three very competitive companies run by three guys, all of which who have really strong egos and sense of self. But if you look and listen to Murph and you look and listen to Ben, they're much more approachable than Adam. Adam has this persona that is, I know more than you. He's seriously a bad boy. But you look at these two other guys, they're serious financial guys. Ben's runs this family office that's worth billions because of their relationship to Jim Beam. Murph comes out of hedge funds where he started and ran a company that had $30 billion under management. Adam doesn't have that kind of pedigree. These guys are sitting back calmly telling their story, and Adam is jumping up there like Crazy Eddie. My prices are insane. And
half our audience will not know what that is.
And then the other half are just shaking their head and rolling their eyes at me, which I understand. it's just to see these three guys who, they're big multi-state operators. and the difference in the way that they present their stories is indicative, I think, of the both the seriousness of the industry and a lot of the immaturity still in it. Yeah. The other thing that was really cool and a little pat on your back and my back is, you know, after most of the panels, I would go up and introduce myself to the CEOs of these companies. And more than a few of them had been listening to us. So thank you for doing so. You know, we really, you know, I know we say this all the time. It blows me away that a large part of my job is that I get to talk about and work in this industry and to see it professionalized and to see these men and women and the, and by the way, some really impressive female CEOs. The CEO of Mary's Medicinals has a great story. Sneak peek, we're going to be interviewing her in a couple of weeks.
Awesome. I'm really excited for that one. I think that'll be really fun.
Yes. And then another person we met is one of the only female CFOs in the industry. We're going to be chatting with her. I think part of the value of us going was to continue to gain access to the types of guests that, you know, I hope you, our audience, likes. And if there's somebody that you want us to speak with, we'll reach out. I know Marvin Washington, the one of the founders of Isodial, will be on, and we're really looking forward to talking to him about the social justice side of this. We're actually going to have a couple of veterans on to talk about the issues that veterans face and how they can use cannabis to treat PTSD. So we're really looking for other ideas that you want to hear from us about, because while we're supposed to be having fun here, it's also important for us to talk about the real issues that are going on in the space.
You guys, we just spoke to Ziggy freaking Marley. We may need a minute to recover. We really hope you enjoyed this chat as much as we did. For all the latest Ziggy news, go to ZiggyMarley.com, or you can follow him on Twitter at Ziggy Marley. Make sure you pre-order Rebellion Rises wherever you buy music, and check out our notes section. We'll have a link to all of Ziggy's upcoming tour dates right in there. As always, thanks so much for listening. If you like us, please come back and listen. It would be so helpful if you guys can subscribe to The Green Rush on iTunes, Stitcher, or wherever you get your podcast from. We want to hear from you. We would love to start incorporating something like email questions from our listeners into these interviews. So shoot us your questions, comments, suggestions. Like, what else could Lewis be doing better? And you can reach us at greenrush@kcsa.com or reach out to us on Twitter or Instagram at kcsa-cannabis. Have a great week.